حبيبي إله العالمين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. Respected brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. قال الله تعالى في كتابه الكريم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ولقد آتينا لقمان الحكمة أن اشكر لله ومن يشكر فإنما يشكر لنفسه ومن كفر فإن الله غني حميد وإذ قال لقمان لابنه وهو يعظه يا بني لا تشرك بالله إن الشرك لظلم عظيم صدق الله العلي العظيم. After pointing out that Luqman was given the wisdom by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And a wisdom is given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we pointed out what exactly that wisdom is according to the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defines the wisdom that Luqman was given, anishkur lillah. If Allah says, وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا لُقْمَانَ الْحِكْمَةَ أَنِشْكُرْ لِلَّهِ, show appreciation, show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is one of the greatest forms of wisdom. Someone who's wise, they're going to show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. And worship, obedience, taking care of what you have, all of that falls under gratitude. So there are many ways where an individual can show gratitude, can show appreciation and thanks. One of the ways is through the tongue, al-shukr bil-lisan, to say alhamdulillah, to show words of gratitude while speaking. Another is with action. If someone has done something good for you, you go in with action, you show that you appreciate. And you show that with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well, through action, through ibadah, through fasting, through charity, through many ways. Also, another very important way is by taking care of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. So if God has given you body, God has given you health, take care of that health. That's a way of showing gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If God has given you a family, take care of that family. Be responsible in the family. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you anything, take care of it to show that you appreciate what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And of course, some of the greatest gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give an individual is children. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you children, that's a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to you. So that your name continues, so your legacy continues. And every person wishes to have children. Every person wishes to leave behind something or someone after they leave this world. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us that the prophets wanted. And Luqman, in his way of showing appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Luqman, he comes and he shows his appreciation by admonishing and guiding his son. That's his way of showing appreciation. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a son. So in order to show appreciation to Allah, he admonishes his son and he raises his son in the best way possible. So Allah says in the Quran, when Luqman said to his son while he was instructing him, O my son, do not associate anything with Allah. Indeed, association with God is great injustice. So he begins a series of advice. And the first thing, he wants to build the foundation. He tells his son, Ya bunay, وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِظُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. He begins admonishing his son, because that's the way he's showing appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the way he's showing appreciation for what he has. He makes sure that it becomes something good. So he wants his son to be on the right path. And he begins admonishing him. He begins giving him advice. He begins enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. And the first piece of advice he gives his son, يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ. Oh, my dear son, do not associate a partner with Allah. إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Because associating a partner with Allah is a great act of oppression. It's a great act of injustice. Now, this brings us several very important topics of discussion that we need to talk about. One is the role of the parents. What is the role of parents? How can I be a good parent? What is good parenting? How can I be a successful parent? For some people, their idea of being a successful parent means I have to feed my children, I have to clothe my children, I have to put a roof over their head, I have to put them in the best schools, I have to make sure that they're financially secure, and they're going to be independent to be able to live on their own. Yes, this is being a good parent. Being a good parent requires all of these things. However, there is a very important ingredient that we see many parents, they miss out on. And that is the admonishment towards their children. That is guiding their children. Just as you care for their physical well-being, just as you care that they're clothed, make sure that they have a spiritual well-being. Make sure that they have a proper upbringing, which prepares them for this life and for the afterlife. And this is the task of a parent. Do not confine parenting to just taking care of your children, buying them the best, you know, shoes, putting them in good schools, going and starting at a young age and, you know, putting a savings account for them. These are all good things. I'm not saying a parent should not do that. A parent should do that. A parent should care for the worldly well-being of their children. However, the parents should also give great attention and care to the well-being of the akhirah, the well-being of the afterlife. Especially we live in a time where it's very difficult to raise children. Raising a family, making sure that your family is secure, making sure that your family is safe from outside influences is very difficult. This is a challenge that many people deal with. Whether you're living in the United States, whether you're living in the West or not, wherever you are, today all over the world, parents, they find it difficult to raise their children because the whole world has become a global village. Today, it's not just you who has an impact on your children. Today, you are sharing the time with the YouTubers and the bloggers and the gamers and whoever it is. They're also influencing your children. So there's a race on who can impact your child more. You or the outside world. You or social media. You as a parent or whatever's coming inside the house through the internet, through games, through whatever it is, through the school, through outside the house. There's a race to influence your children. And we find many of the religious parents, many of the good mu'mineen parents who are always at the mosque, who are believers, who pray all the prayers, who fast, who go to hajj, you find that this is a struggle with many parents. And this is why raising children is a duty. Not just to make sure that they have the physical well-being, that they're fed and they're well-nurtured and they have a roof over their head. We have a duty. If you're a parent, you have a duty to make sure that your children are equipped to be able to deal with the challenges of life after you. You make sure that you give them the means that will connect them with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You find some parents, they give their children everything that they want, but they don't give them the most important thing that their children need, and that is spirituality. That is a mindset and a perspective that connects them with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A good parent is a parent that admonishes their children. A good parent is a parent that guides their children, helping them find the path, helping them in the struggles of this life. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us to do. It's not just an ethical thing. It's not just a moral thing. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا O you people who believe, strengthen yourself, protect yourselves, strengthen your own immunity and your children and your family. Make sure that you have, that your family, that you're raising, the family, the household that you're living in, make sure that that is a house that is protected from the hellfire. Just as you want to protect them from the dangers of this life, just as you don't want your children to leave the house so that they're not exposed to a virus, so that, you know, dangers do not come to them, make sure that you are protecting your family and your children from the dangers that will affect their spirituality and their heart. Allah says in the Quran, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا لَا نَسْأَلُكَ رِزْقًا نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى Allah says in the Quran, you have one very important duty towards your family, towards your children. And that is to guide them and to command them and order them to pray. وَأْمُرْ أَمُرْ There's an order. وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا And be extra patient. Be extra vigilant. Constantly, if you see your son has not prayed, you tell your son, get up and pray. So this is the way that you send a message to your family, to your children. And you tell them. And Allah says, وَاصْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا Be extra patient. Be extra vigilant. لَا نَسْأَلُكَ رِزْقًا We're not asking you for money. We're not asking you for wealth. Allah does not want that from you. Some people, they are running their whole life after paying the bills, doing this and do that, making money. And meanwhile, they have neglected their own children. Meanwhile, they have neglected to order their children to do what is right. Allah says, "Na nas'aluka rizqa, nahnu narzuquk wal 'aqibatu lit-taqwa." We will give you your risk. Don't worry about it. Some people, they say, I don't have time to sit with my family. I don't have time to teach them to pray. I don't have time to sit and admonish them because I'm busy trying to pay the mortgage. Yes, working is good. مَنْ لَا مَعَاشَ لَهُ لَا مَعَادَ لَهُ The one who doesn't work, they're not working for their afterlife either. But you have to strike a balance. You have to keep a balance between this life and the afterlife. And the afterlife is what is more important. Your children are your legacy. Your children are what you leave behind. And this is why we see the prophets of Allah. All of the prophets, there's one thing that was on their mind. There was one thing that was concerning them. And that was, not only do they want to have children, but they have to raise their children in a proper way. They have to make sure that their children are prepared and well-equipped. They give their children the language. They educate their children with the means and the language to connect with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is through prayer. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he says, رَبِّ جَعَلْنِي مُقِيمَ الصَّلَاةِ وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِي رَبَّنَا وَتَقَبَّلْ دُعَاءِ Oh Allah, make me be from the ones who uphold prayer and my progeny and my children. Oh Allah, accept our dua. Ibrahim was always doing dua for his children. In the beginning, he didn't have a child. He keeps asking. And then Allah gives him a child. And then he and Ismail, they both build the Kaaba. And then after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested him, قَالَ إِنِّي جَاعِلُكَ لِلنَّاسِ إِمَامًا Allah tells him, I have made you, I have given you the position of imama. He says, قَالَ وَمِن ذُرِّيَّتِي He's once again asking about his progeny. You see, he was always concerned about his family. And similarly, we see Luqman, he's also taking on the task of showing appreciation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through what? Through guiding his son, through admonishing his son. And he admonishes his son. Allah says in the Quran, وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِظُهُ Luqman says to his son, as he's admonishing him, يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ And Luqman has a series of admonishments that he gives his son. Some of them are in the Quran and others are in Hadith. And inshallah we will discuss them. But Luqman, he didn't just give his son one advice and then that's it, he goes. Luqman made sure that he continuously advises his son. Imam al-Sadiq alayhi salam, he says, فَوَعَظَ لُقْمَانِ إِبْنَهُ بَاثَارِ حَتَّى تَفَطَّرَ وَانْشَقْ. The son of Luqman, his name is Bathar. So Imam al-Sadiq says, Luqman kept admonishing and admonishing his son, حَتَّى تَفَطَّرَ وَانْشَقْ, until he began to crack and he opened. What does that mean? This is a metaphor to a fruit. When a fruit is ripe, you see, for example, a pomegranate. If it's ripe, it's going to open up. Tafattar, it's going to crack and it's going to open up. That means it's ripe. That means it's ready. That means it's it could be going on its own. Luqman, he kept advising his son. Because as a parent, I don't know. I don't have a guarantee how many years I have with my children. I don't have a guarantee how much longer I could live. So as a parent, I have to take that opportunity, every opportunity I have, to guide my children, to speak to them, to one word here and there, to help them be prepared. Now, some parents, since we're talking about admonishment and upbringing and raising children, some parents, they come and they say, "Listen, Sayed, I can't. I keep talking and talking and talking. They don't listen to me. I can't. What am I supposed to do?" Here, we know that as a duty, every person is supposed to do what their duty is. I have a duty to enjoin the good and forbid the evil. Now, if that person does not accept what I say, that means they're not doing their duty. But I have to continue my duty. As a parent, I have that duty. I have to continue my duty. And sometimes you're successful, sometimes you're not successful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us that Prophet Nuh alayhi salam, he was a prophet. He was an old man. And he has to guide his son. He has to keep telling his son, come with me. But his son rejected. وَقَالَ ارْكَبُوا فِيهَا بِسْمِ اللَّهِ مَجْرَاهَا وَمُرْسَاهَا إِنَّ رَبِّي لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. He tells the people, come and ride the ark with me. Allah is merciful. وَهِيَ تَجْرِي بِهِمْ في موج كالجبال ونادى نوح ابنه وكان في معزل يا بني اركب معنا ولا تكن مع الكافرين. Nuh was an old man. He was with his people for over 950 years. So the time of the flood, it was at the end. So he was an old man, and his son was an old man. His son was probably really old. So Nuh, he tells his son, Ya Bunay, oh my dear child, come with us. But his son was arrogant. His son would not listen. But Nuh, he kept doing what his duty is, and that is to guide, and that is to admonish. Now, whether your son or your daughter accepts or does not accept, that's something else. You have to continue your duty. And just because they don't listen to you does not mean that you're a failure as a parent. Nuh was not a failure as a parent. He was a prophet of Allah. But his son rejected the advice and the admonishment of the father. But many times, the approach and the method of admonishing and guiding children from the parents, many times that is flawed, and that is why you have problems that arise. I'm not saying that this is always the case, because Prophet Nuh was a prophet of Allah, and he's guiding his son in the best way possible, and his son took the path of misguidance. This happens. However, we have to make sure that our approach and our methodology is correct. It's sound. Sometimes, one error that some parents have is that they send mixed messages. You come and you tell your son or your daughter something, but in action, you're doing something totally different. Children, even at a young age, they have common sense. They have logic. They know when there's inconsistency in action. If you're guiding, but then you're doing the opposite, then that means that you're not really guiding. That means you just want to say something, but you're doing something else. And remember, many times, a lot of the wrong that children pick up at a young age, they pick it up from their parents. Maybe the parents were not intending to teach their children that wrong, but they picked it up. They see their parents, the way they talk to others, when their parents are backbiting, when their parents are fighting with one another, when their parents are doing this and that, they pick up and they learn. And they learn, and their actions are picked up from their parents. So So we have to be very careful that we do not send wrong messages. One day, a father or a parent came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and he tells Rasulullah, "Ya Rasulullah, my son has a problem. My son eats dates. He's always eating dates. And it's bad for him. I don't want him to eat so much dates." Dates were the, you know, the chocolate of that time. The Hershey, the Snickers, whatever you're craving right now. Just imagine that. So he tells his son, he tells Rasulullah, "My son, he's always eating dates. So can you talk to my son, please? You're the prophet. My son will probably, he looks up to you. He'll listen to you." So Rasulullah, he tells the man, "Yes, I will talk to your son. But come back tomorrow." So the man, he said, okay. He comes back the next day. He's bringing his son. He's holding his son's hand. He brings him to Rasulullah. Rasulullah tells him, "Oh, young man, it's not good, you know, having too much. Even if something is good for you, having too much of it is going to be harmful." And the boy was convinced and he left. The father, he came to Rasulullah. He tells Rasulullah, "Ya Rasulullah, it was so easy for you. It just took you 1 minute to talk to my son. Why is it that you told me come back tomorrow? Why didn't you just tell him yesterday?" Rasulullah tells him, "Because yesterday I had dates. I don't want to be sending mixed messages." See, Rasulullah, even in his admonishment, he's being truthful. And this is the sign of a wise person. A wise person is someone who does not just act wise in front of people, but someone who is wise with him or herself first. And you admonish yourself before admonishing other people. This is one point. Another very important point for parents is a lot of parents, when they see their children doing something wrong here and there, right away, "Don't do this, don't do that, do this and do that." Just giving orders. How many times have we sat and listened to what's going on in our children's minds? What struggles are they facing in college, at the high school? What struggles are they facing in life? Maybe they're falling in this sin as a result of that struggle that they're dealing with. And I need to find a solution to that struggle. So listen to them. Listening to them, you could be admonishing them just by listening to them. Some children, they just need someone to talk, listen to them. When you listen to your children, you're going to develop that trust. Once you develop that trust, then you will be able to talk to them. You need some bonding time. You need some spending time with one another without that just giving orders here and there. Because if you're starting it off by giving orders, that relationship, it's not going to be, they're not going to see it as your, you know, they're not going to feel that you have built a bond with them. Listen to them so that you can build a bond. Another very important point is that as a parent, even though you're the parent and what you want has to go, and that is the truth and whatever the case may be, but as a parent, respect the intellectual, you know, respect the intellectual capacity of your children. What does that mean? That means that speak even to your children, even though they're your children and whatever you say has to go, but speak to them with logic. Speak to them using the power of the intellect. Don't only use emotions. Some parents, they only use emotions when they're talking to their children. When they get angry or they're happy, they start reacting. Use intellect. Use logic when you talk to people, anyone, when you're giving advice to them. Because at the end of the day, every single one of us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us with the intellect. And that intellect, it helps us weigh decisions. And we make decisions using our intellect. A man comes to Rasulullah in front of the Muslims and he says, "Ya Rasulullah, I like adultery. I want to commit zina." Some of the Muslims, they got really upset. They got really angry. What is this man saying? How can he speak to Rasulullah in this way? And he just says, "I want to commit adultery." So Rasulullah tells him, "Come here." They wanted to beat him up. Rasulullah says, "Leave him. I'm going to talk to him." He comes. Rasulullah tells him, "Listen, do you have a mother? Do you have a sister?" He said, "Yes, I do." He tells him, "Would you be happy if someone wants to commit adultery with your own mother?" He says, "No, I would not be happy." Because adultery means taking advantage of someone, having a relationship without giving them their rights. marriage, what's the difference between marriage and adultery? Marriage is that we're acknowledging rights. The male and the female, they have rights, and these rights are acknowledged by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's all that it is. A relationship outside of marriage, out of wedlock, means that there's no rights. It could lead to abuse, it could lead to disrespect. So Rasulullah says, would you be okay with someone committing adultery with your mother? He said, no. Then he said, then why would you want that for someone else's mother? And then he said, would you allow someone to commit adultery with your own sister? He said, no. He said, then why would you allow that for someone else's sister? Rasulullah used logic. The man was convinced and he left. He was convinced. Rasulullah used logic, and religion, a lot of it is logical. This is another point. And finally, we have to balance as parents, the parents who say, why don't my children listen to me when I admonish them? Because you have to balance between reward and punishment. A lot of parents, they're either punishing, and only putting in time out and doing this and that and grounding their children and taking away from them. And in some cases, it leads to abuse. Or on the other side, they're only giving them and spoiling them and take this and take that and take that. Both of them are wrong. You have to balance between reward and disciplinary punishment. And this is one of these are some of the ways of admonishing children. So now we move on. وَإِذْ قَالَ لُقْمَانُ لِبْنِهِ وَهُوَ يَعِظُهُ يَا بُنَيَّ لَا تُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Luqman tells his son, oh my dear son, do not associate a partner with Allah, because that is the greatest act of injustice. And this is the message of all of the prophets. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ مِنْ رَسُولٍ إِلَّا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِ أَنَّهُ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنَا فَعْبُدُونَ. Every prophet, Allah sent 124,000 prophets and messengers. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends every prophet with this single most important message. And that is to call people to tawheed, to invite people to monotheism, and to tell people to not associate a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you see that there's so much insistence in the Quran regarding telling people to avoid shirk. The prophets were not sent to introduce people to God as much as they were sent to tell people to not associate a partner with God. Someone says, why? Why aren't there so many proofs and arguments to invite people to believe in God and worship than there are arguments and rhetoric in the Quran telling people not to associate a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The reason for this is because we are innately born with a need, with an inclination to worship. So Allah doesn't need to come and tell me to worship when I have that. Every single person, whether you're a Muslim, you're not a Muslim, even an atheist has an inclination to worship. Even someone who's an agnostic, they have an inclination to worship. We're all driven by that. Yes, in times of comfort, we kind of disregard that feeling. But in times of fear, you see that people will remember God. People will remember that power that they believe in. Anything. So where do people make a mistake? We're born with that fitrah, that innate consciousness that orders us to worship. The place where people started making mistakes and mixing up is what to worship. So people have that desire to worship, but then they started confusing what they're worshiping. So some people, they saw the sun, they started worshiping the sun. Some people saw the stars, the moon, a cow, whatever it is. Or sometimes other people, they started worshiping them. And this is why Allah sends prophets and messengers to tell people to worship the one and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that worshipping anyone other than God and taking a deity any other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a great act of injustice. It's dhulm. It's an act of injustice. Why? Because instead of appreciating the Lord, instead of worshipping the Lord who gave you what you have, who continues to give you what you have, you're worshipping someone else. You're worshipping something else that is unable to help itself, let alone help other people. So this is an act of injustice to Allah. This is an act of injustice to yourself, because you're stripping yourself of the ability to connect to the one who has the ability to change your life. And you're fooling yourself by worshipping an idol or whatever it may be. And it's an oppression to whatever you're worshipping. Because everything out there, every small particle obeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to take something that obeys and worships Allah in its own way, Allah says everything yusabbih, everything glorifies Allah. We can't hear. Every particle, everything out there glorifies Allah. To take something that in itself, it glorifies Allah, and to consider it a deity, then that is an act of oppression to everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks Isa, Jesus, "O Jesus, was it you who told people to worship my mother and I instead of God?" وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهِ يَا عِيسَى بْنَ مَرْيَمْ أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّي إِلَهَيْنِ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ. Did you tell people to take me and my mother as God instead of Allah? قَالَ سُبْحَانَكَ مَا يَكُونُ لِي أَنْ أَقُولَ مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِحَقٍ إِن كُنْتُ قُلْتُهُ فَقَدْ عَلِمْتُهُ تَعْلَمُ مَا فِي نَفْسِي وَلَا أَعْلَمُ مَا فِي نَفْسِكَ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ. Isa, he says, "No, oh Allah, I did not say that. You know, if I were to say that, I would not say anything like that." This is an act of injustice to Jesus, or to anyone who people take as a God. It's an act of injustice to that person. Jesus used to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How can someone come and say Jesus is God himself? And then Allah says, "Inna shirka la dhulmun azim." It's not associating a partner with Allah is not just any type of injustice. It's the greatest form of injustice. It's the greatest act of injustice. So think of whatever act of oppression you have in your mind. Associating a partner with Allah is greater than that. It's greater, it's worse than that. And these are from the words of Luqman, the wise, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala points this out in the Quran. When this verse was revealed, الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. Those who believe and they don't attach their faith with oppression, meaning there's no oppression in their faith. أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ. Those are the ones who have safety. وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. And those are the guided ones. When this verse came down, all of the Muslims, they became sad. Why? They came to Rasulullah. They tell him, "Ya Rasulullah, every single one of us, we're believers, we're mu'mineen, but we've committed some forms of oppression here and there. ظُلْم. When you sin, you're oppressing yourself. When you backbite, you're oppressing. When you lie, when you cheat, whatever you do, any act of sin is a dhulm." So they come and they tell Rasulullah, "Ya Rasulullah, this means that we're not going to be saved." Because the verse says, those who believe and have not committed any oppression. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he does tafsir al-Quran bil-Quran. He interprets one verse using another verse in the Quran. And this is the highest forms of tafsir. This is the best forms of exegesis. So Rasulullah, he says, no. The dhulm that the Quran is talking about in this verse is associating a partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Luqman, he tells his son, "Inna shirka la dhulmun azim." Shirk, associating a partner with Allah, that is the greatest act of injustice. So this verse is saying, if you're a mu'min, then don't go back to shirk. If you're a mu'min, then don't associate a partner with Allah. You have to be very careful. And shirk, associating partners with Allah, has many levels. Some people, they could be mu'mineen, they could be believers, they believe that it's only God, but in action, they're worshipping something else. Their belief system tells them that it's only God, but they're worshipping something else. They're worshipping their life, they're worshipping their desires, they're worshipping money, they're worshipping so many other things that could be worshipped. This is why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, he warns the Muslims. He says, إن الشرك أخفى من دبيب النمل على صفاء سوداء في ليلة ظلماء. He says, shirk in the heart is hidden. It's so hidden. It's as hidden as a black ant that is walking on a rock at night. And that rock is a rugged rock. This is how are you going to be able to see that ant? You won't be able to see it. It will be very difficult. Rasulullah, he warns the Muslims, he says, be very careful where you do not fall in shirk. Where you do not associate partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you're in need, who do you turn to? Do you turn to God or do you turn to other people? When you're struggling, who do you go to? You go to Allah or you go to other people? We have to cleanse ourselves. We have to make sure that our objective and our mission in life is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nothing and no one else. This is one another point. A third point, and I will quickly go through this, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, إِنَّ الشِّرْكَ لَظُلْمٌ عَظِيمٌ. Associating a partner with God, it's an act of injustice. Here, we learn that there are certain absolute truths that do not require religion for you to learn about them. So the measure of associating a partner with God, Allah says in the Quran, it's oppression. And I don't need to teach you what oppression is because you are built innately knowing what is oppression. So you don't need to be a religious person. You don't need to read the Quran or the Torah or the Injil or any divine scripture to know exactly what oppression is. Every single one of us, just as we have that innate desire to find a Lord, we also have that innate desire, or we also have that innate consciousness that helps us distinguish between justice and injustice. And we know an act of oppression when we see it. So Luqman is telling his son, associating a partner with God, that's an act of oppression. And you already know what an act of oppression is because Allah created you with that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you with that internal navigation system, with that internal GPS, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has guided you. سبح اسم ربك الأعلى الذي خلق فسوى والذي قدر فهدى. Allah destined and guided. And God guided you in many ways. One is your internal guidance, and He sent external guidance, and that is through the prophets and the messengers and the books. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us all and to help us. نسألك اللهم وندعوك باسمك العظيم الأعظم الأعز الأجل الأكرم يا الله يا الله يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. تابع اللهم بيننا وبينهم بالخيرات إنك مجيب الدعوات إنك غافر الخطيئات إنك على كل شيء قدير. اللهم ادخل على أهل القبور السرور. اللهم أغني كل فقير. اللهم أشبع كل جائع. اللهم اكسو كل عريان. اللهم اقضي دين كل مدين. اللهم فرج عن كل مكروب. اللهم رد كل غريب. اللهم فك كل أسير. اللهم أصلح كل فاسد من أمور المسلمين. اللهم اشفي كل مريض. اللهم سد فقرنا بغناك. اللهم غير سوء حالنا بحسن حالك. اللهم اقض عنا الدين وأغننا من الفقر. إنك على كل شيء قدير. وإلى أرواح المؤمنين والمؤمنات نهدي ثواب الفاتحة مع الصلوات. اللهم صل على محمد.